It's remarkable to me that everybody who professes to want quality educations for their kids can't figure out the best way to evaluate teachers when everybody knows the good ones and the bad ones.
Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandee. Today, the Senate Finance Chairman is here to talk about how the budget negotiations are going. How are you, Senator?
I'm doing well. How they're going is we're basically in step one. After the governor presented his budget, we're now hearing from everybody on every aspect of the budget.
Right. And on the education reform issue, school districts, they needed to have an evaluation plan in place by January 17th, or they lost out on millions of dollars for their schools. Now, your districts were able to submit plans, most did, but New York City lost out on that money. Here's part of your exchange with union leaders who are a part of that teacher evaluation negotiation.
Do you acknowledge, all three of you, acknowledge that there are good teachers and there are bad teachers? All right. And you acknowledge that good teachers should be praised and remunerated in accordance with that excellence, and bad teachers shouldn't be teaching. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Nobody else is answering, but I assume that's, I would hope.
It's like in any profession, you wouldn't want a
exactly.
bad cop or
there's
a bad
good,
legislator.
There's no. good legislators, but.
There you go.
There's good yeah. union officials, bad union officials.
And we could go on for hours.
Yeah, okay.
About this.
And yes. My point is, so there is a need for somehow for this state to evaluate teachers.
All right, so. No results, no solutions in order to get funding for New York City schools.
What's amazing about this whole process is the school districts had a year to negotiate between the unions and the school district to come up with a plan. And all but six upstate districts, that's hundreds of them, all but six got a plan. New York City, which represents half of the students, couldn't do it. And that's why I was asking questions of those officials.
Right. So now they're asking you, as the finance chairman, to help them get their money back for their schools. And between Mayor Bloomberg and the union leaders, you got different sides to the story. Let's watch that right now.
Everybody in upstate and all those who did agreed under pressure of their unions as well. There was a deadline set, and I don't remember too many people complaining about the process until the deadline was getting closer. These people had a deadline, they met the deadline. The governor said very clearly there's consequences. And I can't see how, in all honesty, the governor could approve of a budget which would say, well, it has consequences for everybody other than the city of New York. And so I guess what others have said, and my suggestion would be, your bargaining power is going to be substantially greater if you come up with a solution. And hopefully, I'm not only talking to you, I'm talking to the unions. Because we have the same problem in my area as well. So it's a comment. If you care to respond, fine. If you don't,
sure.
That's fine too.
You know, in the end, do you take the money or do you take an evaluation system if it comes down to it? We were unwilling to sign on to an evaluation system, which was, if we had accepted the terms of across the table from the union, would not have been an evaluation system that worked. And I made the decision that we would be better off finding a ways without the money from the state and not compromising on an evaluation system that was a fraud. Keep in mind, we came very close to an evaluation system in terms of how it would work and how it would be implemented and what would happen. It was at the end when the union threw in some things, deal breakers, deliberately to stop it from ever getting implemented.
The next day at the education hearing, the Senate Finance Chairman asked union leaders to clear up the mayor's charge about the negotiation fallout.
Now, a question for me, and hopefully this will put to bed this issue of negotiations for this teachers' evaluations that we're going at. Very simply, did you demand at the 11th hour to double the number of grievances that are brought to arbitration? Yes or no?
No.
Did you bring that up, whether it was the 11th hour or any earlier hour?
Arbitration was discussed.
Well, I'm asking specifically. That doesn't answer the question.
There were numerous proposals at different times, but arbitration was discussed.
The UFT president further explained he made it clear that he thought that it was a waste of time to do class size arbitration the way it was proposed. And he suggested to do 10 arbitrations in a day. and claimed the other side thought it was too much work to accomplish in that time frame.
And what does this have to do with our teacher evaluations?
Because as you implement a new process inside of the school, there will we have 1,706 schools in New York City. So I am sure that some people will do it not correctly. So somebody has a right to say, look, they're not doing this right.
And you already had a grievance procedure in place in your current contract.
We have a grievance procedure in place.
Okay.
But what we said was...
So that wasn't an essential issue in teacher evaluations. If you already had a grievance procedure in place, it wasn't certainly enough to torpedo this discussion.
No, actually, we had settled that issue.
That was settled?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I guess we're really at the end of this thing because someone ain't being totally forthright, and I'm not accusing either side, but this is absurd. And you wonder this poor, I hope this person who wrote this article about his twin sons looks at this and says, all right, no wonder we've got bad teachers in the schoolroom. We can't even agree on how to evaluate. It's just disgusting. It's absolutely disgusting. And we're stuck with bad teachers who are not, clearly not the majority, the small minority that causes so much trouble. And sometimes I wonder whether the concern of the unions is more to protect that bad teacher than it is to make certain, let me finish, to make certain that the system, rather than making certain that the system works so we weed out the bad teachers.
Money's not the answer to everything. Sometimes you got to stand up on principle, and that's what we're doing.
All right, and that was your choice, to stand on principle and take these potential consequences. And I'm just saying, if I was the chief executive, I've never been, you have been. If I set up a system and the legislature set up a system and the deadline comes and goes and 99% of the districts, and small ones, comply and another doesn't, I don't see how anyone could say, well, forget it. We really didn't mean it.
The difference is I don't think they complied. I think the State Department of Education erroneously and outrageously accepted plans they knew were total frauds. You cannot, if this legislature requires 2 years to evaluate a teacher, say you have an evaluation system if it lasts for 1 year. I just don't get it. How can you possibly, there's no ways you can do anything.
But you've done
it. It's just a waste. I signed a piece of paper. I said yes, so I get the money. Okay.
But you didn't have an evaluation system before this. So what's the downside of coming up with a system that would provide the money that you desperately need?
Because it's not a system and it's a fraud on the public. I have to go and look at the public in the eye and say that we had an evaluation system when we didn't. I can't do that.
All right, so two different days. What did you think of their individual tests?
You know, and people wonder why government is having problems. I mean, you have a mayor of the largest city of the state. You have union officials that have two totally different versions of what happened. And it just became apparent as my frustration kept getting greater. It became apparent to me that it's this battle between the two that is more important than the quality of education and whether we're having an honest evaluation system. There were many evaluation systems throughout the state that they could have gone by because many and most, in fact, didn't get a good evaluation system upstate.
Right. And it does seem that, you know, everyone pretty much agrees that good teachers and bad teachers really matters.
Yeah, but there was a hesitation with a couple of the people that were there. It's just frustrating, and we're just continuing to keep pushing in the right direction. It's all I can do.
Right. Now let's talk about your discussion with the Education Commissioner King about the New York school system, specifically the issue of remediation while students are in high school. Let's take a look at that first.
I suggest, and it just seems so logical, and I would wonder if this could possibly be considered by somebody, that if they take the test when they enter college and find out you're not ready, why not take that test when you're entering 12th grade? And if you're not ready, you may not need that math class. That's theory. But you know exactly what this kid needs to become ready. And then they are ready rather than wasting a year and spending millions of dollars to remediate. Now, does that make sense to you?
It does, absolutely.
Okay, how do we make it happen? Mm-hmm.
So we are working with CUNY on exactly that. CUNY has set the Regents exams as one of the ways that they determine whether or not students are placed in credit-bearing courses or remedial courses. So it is possible in the CUNY system to look at an 11th grader and that 11th grader's performance on the Regents exams and determine whether or not that student should take the equivalent of the remedial courses they would take in college as a senior in high school. Much smarter way to use the resources. The challenge for SUNY is that they have different standards for remediation across the 64 campuses, and one of the challenges that they describe in the report is the need to work together to bring their campuses together around a common definition of college readiness that could be implemented in 11th grade.
There's a lot of smart people at SUNY, and it would seem to me that would not be a mind-boggling approach to put all the testing or whatever together and someone within 2 weeks figure out what works and what doesn't work and dictate that that's the test that's going to be. Well, I'll ask SUNY about that, but it's very, very frustrating to me because we're wasting time and then we're trying to catch up. The second aspect that we talked about when we had our major meeting in June, the second aspect was even more important. A lot of these kids will go to college for 1 year, use their grants, use their own money, waste the money, not have a skill, and they never were going to be successful in college. And until we recognize that reality, we're never going to be able to give them a career track. And Senator Felder mentioned about guidance counselors. I was told when I was checking at various colleges that a lot of guidance counselors just say, you got to get to college, you got to get to college, you got to get to college. Somebody's got to direct them to a BOCES program, something. And are we doing anything along those lines right now? What more can we do to have this dual? Yeah, I mean, used to be called mainstreaming and tracking and all this garbage. But the fact of the matter is, realistically, you got to get a kid to be successful somewhere and get guide towards that direction.
Very true. College isn't for everyone. But, you know, I noticed that this conversation was so similar to the same conversation you had last year at the hearings.
And if the members of the public get frustrated that things don't get done, you can see my frustration. It's so logical, these suggestions. They agree with me. And there's always some reason that somebody's got to do something else that is not a very big task, but it seems to never get done. Well, I'm not going to let it go.
Last week when you were here, you said some local representatives from Syracuse were going to come in for the budget hearings. How were they received?
Oh, they were received well. I mean, they were very good presenters. The mayor came in, gave her points of view, as did mayors of other cities. And the county executive from Onondaga County came in and gave very brief remarks, but remarks that gave us some information, at least on Onondaga's county's feeling about this particular budget process, what should be in and what should be out. And most importantly, we all had the opportunity to ask questions. And that helps clarify, not only give us what their opinion is, but clarifies what the basis of that opinion is and whether it makes sense. And because these are the decisions we have to make in a relatively short time.
Right, and you will be off in a few minutes to the environmental conservation hearing.
We will.
Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. This week, additional stakeholders will explain how the budget will affect them, and you can find out what happens by watching it live on nysenate.gov or Channel 83 on your television. You can also get budget details at defrancisco.nysenate.gov. Remember, Your Voice matters. Contact Senator DeFrancisco about your budget concerns.